Hello, everybody out there. It's nice to see you virtually. We are Presidio Brass. We have Steve O'Connor, Jeff Harrigan, myself, Josh Bledsoe, Mike Frasier, and Miles McAllister. And today we are talking think small, play big, using chamber music to build a better band. Or any ensemble, really. If you're a band director, if you are a string director, it doesn't matter. Chamber music offers the same benefits across the board. So I'm going to show you guys a presentation here, and we're going to kind of bounce back and forth between these. But this is our presentation that we're going to share with you guys today. Think small, play big. So first, if you're not really familiar with us, we are Presidio Brass. Presidio Brass was founded in 2006, initially with the mission of bringing music education back into schools where arts programs had been cut. Very shortly thereafter, we were offered our first national touring contract. And 15 years later now, we have performed in 46 states in China, in Canada. We have 4 commercially available CDs. And we are extremely fortunate to have a partnership with KHS America, which provides all of our instruments and helps us go out and continue to promote music education and chamber music in schools. We stick to our original mission everywhere we go. We offer educational clinics. So if we're ever anywhere near your town, you may be hearing from us. And if you notice we're coming close, reach out to us and we'd be glad to work something out. So, you know, we're a chamber music, we're a group, we're a brass quintet, but we have a little bit of a unique flair. So Rick, why don't you show them exactly what we're about? So that's a little bit of who Presidio Brass really is. And, You can tell we take chamber music pretty seriously, even while we're all kind of grounded at home with everything going on with COVID. We're still finding ways to make music with each other, even if it has to be virtual right now. So as we get started, I just wanted to kind of tell everybody a little bit about who we are individually, and let the guys introduce themselves as well. So we have, of course, five people, and I'll go ahead and start. I'm Josh Bledsoe. You probably saw from the video. I play trombone, and I also sing in our main, our big show. I have a bachelor's degree from Florida State University, a master's degree from Arizona State University, and a doctorate from Arizona State University as well. And in the group, I handle our social media, some of our travel arrangements, and all the audiovisual stuff. So this particular video was put together by Mike Frasier, but most of the stuff that we do, a lot of the media materials and videos that you see were usually edited by me, even though Mike Frasier did an absolute bang-up job on this video. So awesome. Why don't we let the guys go through? Steve, why don't you tell our viewers a little bit about who you are?
Well, I'm originally from the East Coast, and I went to school in Michigan, and eventually at Michigan State, and eventually came out to Los Angeles area, where I went to school for my master's at Cal State University, Long Beach. And currently I just play with a variety of groups down in Southern California when I'm not on tour with these guys. And I guess I've been stuck at home for the last year with a 2-year-old terrorist. I have a 2-year-old little boy, and if any of you are parents out there, you know what that's like. So anyway, I'm ready for the world to open back up and to hang out with my buddies on the road again. So I'm going to pass it along to my friend Jeff Harrigan.
Hey, everybody. I'm Jeff Harrigan, originally from Baltimore, Maryland. I was actually part of the group back in 2013 and 2015 or so. Left the group for a couple of years to do some other stuff, and I recently rejoined. So I'll be seeing inconsistencies with the pictures. That's why. When everything shut down, I actually decided to get my master's. So I'm currently in Waco, Texas, getting my master's at Baylor University. So since there's no music, seemed like a great time to go back to school. In the group, I play euphonium down there, trombone, and also some auxiliary percussion. And when we're on the road, I'm basically in charge of the production value of the stuff on stage. So if it's staging and choreography, anything production-wise to help enhance the show on stage to make a better performance for you guys. And I'll pass that off to Mike Frasier.
Hey, everybody. Can't tell from the flag behind me. I live in Chicago. But I'm originally from the great state of Michigan, and that's where I did my undergrad at the University of Michigan, go Blue, and did my master's degree at Northwestern. And I am the tuba slash piano player for the group. I also do, like Josh said, I've been starting to help out with some of the audio video tasks, especially as we do more of that virtually. And I am also the person who is in charge of coordinating our outreach. So like Josh said, we're very passionate about going out and reaching out to schools and teaching just like we're doing now. And if you're interested in something like that, I would be the person that you'd be in contact with. So that's kind of my role with the group. And now I'm going to pass it on to my.
Look at that. Best for last. My name is Miles McAllister. I'm one of two trumpet players in the group, and I only play trumpet. I think that's enough of a responsibility. And when I'm at home, I play at Disneyland. I play second trumpet, and I sub on lead sometimes. And I have a couple positions in some regional orchestras, and then just kind of like general freelancing, and a little teaching on the side as well. But I did my undergraduate at the University of Redlands, and then I did my master's at Cal State Fullerton. And I'm all schooled out for now. So that's a little about me. Take it away, Josh.
All right, so that's who we are, and that's what we do. And now we're going to kind of turn to the meat of this presentation. As you can tell, we are very passionate about chamber music. I think that all five of us in the group, if we were really pressed to give an example of what really grabbed us as musicians, it all points back to some opportunity to play chamber music, because there's a lot of amazing things that and lessons that happen when you are able to play chamber music, when you're able to do that small group thing. And we take those lessons back to the large ensembles that we play with when we're not on the road. So just quickly, you know, why chamber music? Why is chamber music such an important thing? Well, you know, chamber music does a lot of different things. The number one thing, number really, is that it builds a lot of musical independence. And that is, it develops your time. It develops a better sense of intonation. It develops a great confidence about, you know, playing your part as though it is the most important part in the group, because oftentimes it is. And even if it's not, it's still an integral part of the overall musical architecture, regardless of composer and regardless of the setting. And finally, attention to detail. When there's only a few voices, whether it's, you know, a trio or a large brass ensemble, you know, or a large woodwind ensemble, you're able to really get in and key in on the details of making music. And you take that attention to detail, you take that bigger radar right back into the band room when you sit in with a large ensemble. The other thing is it teaches a lot of life skills. And so we call that group dynamics. You know, we understand that not every student is going to go on to be a music major, but they can learn a lot about life and a lot about the various skills necessary to just become successful people. The whole being greater than the sum of its parts. And that's the great thing about chamber music, is that you can take these 5 or 3 or 10 individual voices, and what you get when you mix those together is so much bigger and so much greater than just 8 or 10 voices. You learn collegiality, and I have to be honest, there's the five of us spend an inordinate amount of time with one another. You know, when we're on the road, we're with each other 24 hours a day, and we have to learn, as good of friends as we are, we learn how to really work with each other. We learn to be business people together, but at the same time make decisions that are best for the group. And we learn how to critique each other in a healthy way, and as well learn not to be offended when someone offers up a constructive, or maybe sometimes not so constructive, criticism as well. And then interpersonal communication, you know, learning how to talk to somebody, and just like I was referencing, learning how to say, hey, you know, I think you're a little bit behind there, I think you're a little bit flat, in such a way that doesn't set off that defensive mechanism. And then finally, music business, which can be carried into anything. Goal setting, coming up with goals for the group, for how you want to perform, for how you want to sound. Follow through, starting with a product, an idea for a product, and actually taking that idea all the way through to its logical conclusion, which in the case of music is a performance. And then finally, it's performance driven. You know, we spend so much time preparing for a performance that we sometimes forget and lose perspective on the fact that it's all about the performance. And chamber music gives you that opportunity, because you're able to take the ensemble various places. You're able to use it in different settings. So chamber music is an incredible vehicle for learning all kinds of skills, not just those specific to music. And so now you're probably thinking, okay, that's awesome. Chamber music's great, but how do I make it work? Well, if we take a look at this slide, I'm going to pull this down in a second so you can look at our beautiful faces. But the first thing that we usually are kind of at here is, you know, how do you make it work with the instrumentation? How do you make it work when you don't have necessarily a standard brass quintet or a standard brass choir or a woodwind quintet. How do you make it work? Well, there's standard instrumentation groups are really awesome. They're great. We are sort of an amalgam of non-standard and standard, and we have our own brand. But the problem with standard instrumentation is often that the repertoire is quite difficult, but it's also really academic. It's not necessarily fun for a student to engage. And if it's not fun for the student, it's not going to be fun for the audience member. So you have some options. You can do the standard instrumentation thing. But you can also think about size. You know, any number of players is absolutely applicable here. You can have double and triple parts. You can take a trio and have two people, playing each part, or three people playing each part. It doesn't matter. You can double individual parts. You can turn a trio into a large chamber ensemble. You can also do some substitutions, you know, which most band directors are pretty familiar with. If you've got a really great trumpet player, you can throw a clarinet part at them. And if you've got a really great clarinet player, you might be able to throw a trumpet part at them. Same thing, you know, the B flat instruments, the E flat instruments. So never be afraid to mix it up. And that gets us to non-standard instrumentation. And that's where the real magic happens. See, when you start getting people to interact that don't often interact either personally or sonically, you know, you don't really have a trumpet player sitting next to a alto sax player very often, but that opens up a lot of possibilities for creative possibilities that you can play all kinds of different repertoire, but you can create a lot of different sounds, different timbres when the sounds are mixed, technical possibilities. You know, obviously a trombone player is probably not going to be playing Fly to the Bumblebee, but you know, you've got the technique available if you've got a tenor sax or an alto sax in that group as well. And it becomes really engaging for the viewer. It becomes really engaging for the audience to look up there and see a different mix of instruments. And that is a very marketable thing. You can send that group out into your community. You can bring your community in for various events and such that can feature these mixed instrumentation or non-standard instrumentation groups. Cool. So that's the first thing, making it work, right? How do you make it work with that? So now we're going to move on. Sorry, repertoire. That's the big one, right? Repertoire. Well, this is the biggest question that most music educators throw at us, which is, all right, well, you know, it's really great, but where do we find the music? Well, you have a few different options. You know, you can choose that warhorse repertoire, but it comes with some pros and cons. It's great for a really self-motivated group of students, but it's usually really difficult. Again, it's really intellectual, and you have to ask yourself, who am I really trying to engage? And ultimately, what we can talk about a lot here at Presidio is, are we doing this because it makes us feel good? Are we doing it because it makes the audience feel good? And you have to find that balance between what's engaging for the performer and what's engaging for the audience member. Warhorse repertoire, you know, your Bonkle Sonkle leader, your Nielsen woodwind quintets, you know, those kinds of things are great, but are they really engaging your listener? So that's when we get into flexible arrangements. Flexible arrangements are awesome. I didn't mention this in the intro, but I'm actually I'm a band director myself. I'm the director of bands at Pensacola State College here in Pensacola, Florida. And with the pandemic, we have actually had to use some flex band arrangements because I've got some strange instrumentation sometimes from and also, you know, I get kids having to miss. So honestly, though, I have turned those flex band arrangements into chamber music opportunities for some of my other students. So, you know, you've got four parts that can be played by any instrument. You can really do some amazing things timbrally with those flex band charts. And I know a lot of people have those. Additionally, you know, you can do part substitution like I talked about. clarinet and trumpet can kind of interchange depending on the repertoire and the demands of the repertoire, oboe and flute, et cetera. You know, if you've got a trombone player that's adept at tenor clef, they can play a tenor sax part. A trombonist can play a trumpet part if they can read tenor clef. They can play bari sax parts. So you can do a lot of flexing of the instrumentation just with some subtle substitutions and a little bit of creativity. And finally, arranging. And this is where the magic comes in, because you can take any piece that you want. You can imagine most of the charts we play are not commercially available. La La Land we could not just reach out and say, hey, I would like to find an arrangement of La La Land that uses piano and brushes and cowbell and two trombones and two trumpets. You know, it just doesn't exist. So we leaned on Mike Frasier, we actually leaned on a former member. Mike Frasier has done arrangements of The Music Man as well as some other stuff for us. But we lean on our colleagues and sometimes within the group to do custom arrangements. And so if you have a particularly hungry student, a lot of times they would be glad to do an arrangement and have that arrangement performed. That's a big draw for a student. Of course, a band director or other music educator can also do those arrangements. And it gives you access to a lot of different styles. The repertoire is really where you're going to engage the students. And it's great to find a balance between something that's fun for them, challenging at the same time, but also engaging so that they are interested in playing it. And oftentimes, some of the more warhorse type repertoire is just not that engaging for our young students. And at the end of the day, what we're really using chamber music for is not necessarily an education in repertoire, but it's an education in a set of skills that they can then take into the rest of their lives, but they can also bring right back into the band room and apply those into your large ensemble settings. So that's making it work for the repertoire. How do you get performance opportunities? You know, we talked about follow through, taking something from its inception all the way to a performance. So you have some finite kind of opportunities with performance. You can certainly do community-based performance opportunities. Those are all over the place. I realize right now some of them are kind of limited, but you know, there's all kinds of nursing homes and community groups, you know, your local community groups and things of that nature. But you can also create schools sponsored chamber music series, just a full concert just of the various groups in your band and their chamber music groups. And ultimately, one of the things that Presidio, we all kind of got together and talked, and we really agree that oftentimes, you know, what happens is you have a chamber group and you stick them at the beginning or the middle of a concert and they play something, and they're sort of a side act to the large ensembles. But there's really a lot of magic in having a concert opportunity that is just chamber group. It's so intimate, and the audience is able to connect with the music that's happening on stage because it is so transparent and it's much smaller. They can really engage with the musicians, and it's just a totally different vibe that's really valuable, that's a lot of fun for both the performer and the audience. Separate performances from the band concert, if possible, are really valuable for the student. Making it work, packaged product. You know, Presidio, from the bottom to the top, is a completely produced product. You know, everything is well thought out. Everything is on purpose. So all the movements that you see us do, all of the choreography that we do, all of the many of our speeches are all, you know, there's a lot of flexibility, but we have rehearsed those speeches over and over and over again so that they're very fluid. And the repertoire that we play, that we choose to play, is done with a particular arc, a particular goal at a certain point in time in the show, we want to reach out and grab you. And then we want to turn right back around and maybe make you want to hug your loved one or give your mom a call and say, I miss you, mom, something like that. But everything has a purpose. And so you can start to get your students engaged by actually creating a show, actually creating a product, a packaged product. And that goes everywhere from what you wear. You know, Presidio wears on the first half, we have gray suits. We all have the same brown shoes. We all have the same shirt and tie. We look sharp, but we look professional. And on the second half, all bets are off. You know, it's individual style, but it's all very well thought out. And it's all done on purpose to engage the audience. And so that's something that is very valuable for students, because oftentimes students aren't responsible for that. You know, the band director decides the repertoire and says, okay, you know, you show up 30 minutes before, you walk out on stage, you go home after it's done. Getting the students involved and responsible for the overall arc of the show can be a really valuable thing. And it teaches them follow through skills, and it teaches them the very important skill, which at 36 years old tomorrow, I am still learning, which is when I have a big idea, I got to figure out how to actually make it happen instead of just thinking, hey, I had a really great idea and it never leaves my notebook. And finally, you know, we understand that students are not going to necessarily go on to study music. They're going to go on and do other things with their life. And hopefully we develop in them a love of music. And chamber music is one of those things that is very easy to do as you get older. It's a lot easier to find three or four other people who'd like to play together on occasion and have those skills than it is to find 45 or 50 or 60 other people and form a band. And so you teach those skills through music that they can take into their lives. You know, have the students develop a press kit. That means a photo. It means some kind of recording. It can mean a website. There's a lot of different places where you can put a free website. You're not going to have a custom domain name, but that's not the point. The point is to have a press kit, a developed product that someone can see. And there's a lot of value in doing that. It doesn't have to be a professional picture. It could be a kid's mom outside with their smartphone, but you have a press photo. You have a package that you can present. Coming up with a name. And a name that potentially means something to the group, because you never know what kind of legs these groups are going to grow. A digital presence. Have the kids develop a social media account and post, you know, short videos of themselves and create these posts. And that's an excellent education for some of these things that they're going to do when they go on into their professional lives. And find a faux business model. You know, it's easy to say, hey, I got a brass quintet and we're going to go play concerts, but how do you do that? And so, you know, developing a faux business model that says, hey, here's the kind of group we're going to be. Here's the kind of music we're going to play. Here's the venues that we would like to play. And here's how we're going to actually get into those venues, how we're going to make money, how we're going to reinvest that money into the group. These are all excellent things that you can take into your life after high school and potentially take into your community. There's a number, especially where I live. I know Steve and Miles are in LA. There's a lot of what we call local brass quintets or community brass groups that do basically what Presidio does, just on a slightly smaller scale. They're out there, they have a brand, they're performing in their community. And those people might not necessarily have music degrees, but they all studied music in school. And because they have those skills, they have either something that's very rewarding personally for them that they can do, and also bring in some extra income if they choose to go that route. Wonderful. So now, I know most of you probably came here for the rehearsal techniques. I've put a few rehearsal techniques on here. And, you know, we use all of these plus a whole bunch of others that are kind of specific to Presidio and our various needs and the various demands of our show. But the ones that are up here are absolutely the tried and true. They're the killers of music ensemble pedagogy. But the big thing to remember, the overarching theme of all of this, is that none of these exercises, none of these techniques are necessarily intended to make a passage or a piece of music perfect. The purpose of most of these is to expand the radar of the individual musician and to get them to listen just a little bit more intently. So if a passage is, you know, particularly rough, doing one or two of these might not solve it, but it might open that student's radar up just a little bit so that the global product gets better as the more difficult skill is being developed over a longer period of time. So we'll just kind of quickly explain some of these. We've got air it out. Air it out is just basic breathing. Presidio does some sort of breathing every single time we go on stage, every single time we rehearse. And a lot of times we keep it pretty basic. Four in, four out, two in, two out, one in, one out, one in, three out, which is excellent for training, pushing that breath far to the right so you don't have these big gaps. Every music educator knows you got a whole note and then there's a big gap on two and three as the student takes a breath that seems to last an eternity. And I deal with it every day as a college band director, and it drives me crazy, and I know it does you too. But have them breathe. This does a lot more than just open up the sound. It actually forces the group to develop a group opinion of time. So do it with a metronome, which is going to increase the ability to play and perform in time. You take that right back into the band room. Do it without a metronome, and then the students have to rely on each other, both aurally, listening for the breath, and visually. You know, I can tell you, I can look at Steve when we're playing on stage, and I can tell you when he's about to breathe. I just by looking at him. Same thing with the other people. And so being able to anticipate that means if I can tell if Steve's about to breathe, I'm not going to breathe in the same spot. I'm going to try to stagger that breath. And that's a really valuable thing to take into a large ensemble. Blind listening. This is, you know, you can either do this by closing your eyes. You can do this any number of ways. But what this does is have the players do anything, close their eyes, but you learn to breathe and you learn to anticipate note changes. It gets you to use your ears to hear the very nuanced things that happen when someone is about to change a note, when someone is playing a particular passage. And so, you know, it requires that they might have to memorize something, but you can do it with rounds. You can do it with everybody playing something in unison. It doesn't matter. But the goal is to get the ears to be really big. Make no mistake, it's going to sound terrible when you close your eyes and you play. If you haven't been doing this a long time, if you close your eyes and you play, it's not going to be good. But the point is to get them to listen really hard so that when they do open their eyes, the radar is bigger, the attention to detail is that much more narrow, and you achieve a greater level of fluency as a group. Turn your back. This is a lot similar to blind closing your eyes, except for, you know, you can actually see your music. But it gets you to listen to breathing and pacing. You're less reliant on immediate feedback from close sounds, and that's why you would face away from one another. It's really easy when everybody's playing in a circle or you're in kind of a standard brass quintet formation or chamber music formation. You're right across from somebody. You get that immediate feedback from their bell. But when you turn away from any from your colleagues, suddenly there's less feedback right near your ears. You have to listen that much more intently to make sure that you're staying in time, because you're getting reflection and you're getting the dry source. You know, you're getting the source that's actually coming from the performer's bell. And so that's an excellent exercise to not rely on close sounds, which translates into the band room as, hey, I'm listening to the flute right now. I'm listening to the saxophone, and you know, I'm sitting in the trombone section, but I'm not totally relying on the guy playing next to me. I've got my ears in other places. Just from a musical standpoint, bop, forte piano, you know, you cut out all the sustain. Forte piano is great for really getting your articulation secure, confidence in the articulation. It also highlights rhythmic inaccuracies, as well as any note center accuracies. It's impossible to forte piano a note that's not centered. Take a solo. Basically, everybody performs their part as if it were a solo line. This generates opinion in every part. So it takes away that, you know what, I'm just playing a whole note, so I'm kind of going to sit back here and do nothing. If you take that whole note and you turn it into something really important, when you mix it all back in, you might dial down the opinion a little bit, but it's going to be that much more interesting if every player in the group has an opinion about their line, even if it's not the solo or melodic thematic material. Windhorn, we use this all the time. It's probably our go-to rehearsal technique. And perform large sections of the piece, moving air through the instrument only, don't make a sound. And it really gets you to listen, really gets you to hear each player's articulation, really gets you to hear their sustain. And it's incredibly valuable because, again, it's not going to be perfect right away. You're going to have people in different places by the end of it. But if they really start to listen, that group time, the group opinion about dynamic flow is going to be off the charts. And moreover than that, the next time they go to pick up that instrument and make a sound, it's going to have so much more body, so much more resonance than it was before. Finally, be a producer. Presidio records video and audio every single show, and we sit down the next day, maybe after the show, and we chill out and we listen and we critique the show as if we were producing a record or producing a performance. And that doesn't necessarily mean just listening to ourselves. It means watching the video, listening to the audio, and making critiques based on the group as a whole and not necessarily any individual just in one part. And where the music educator comes into this is that you really have to coax the student into productive listening and offering productive feedback. It's really easy to listen to a recording and say, I cracked a note right here. You cracked a note. Oh, you were really out of tune. You came in at the wrong time. And that's not really evaluating. That is just error detection. It doesn't help anything. So you can coax the students into making actionable evaluations in lieu of just pointing out errors. And that develops really big ears to be able to listen to yourself and critique yourself sort of from an outside looking in perspective. And you can also do this with recordings of professional brass quintets or professional chamber ensembles. You know, put on a recording of the Enso string quartet or Manozzo brass and have your students critique that performance as if they were a producer. Sure, there's going to be a lot of goofy stuff in there, but the ears, if you can listen to something like that and say, you know, maybe I would have had a bigger crescendo here, or I would have gotten even softer. Those kinds of things are going to be taken into the band room, and they're going to be that much more detail oriented and that much more responsible for their own part because they're listening with bigger ears, bigger radar. And finally, inception, a chamber music within a chamber music group. One of our biggest influences and our biggest mentors in Presidio Brass was Sam Palafian, one of the founders of the Empire Brass Quintet, and just, you know, all around one of the, probably the, at least for me, the best musician that I have ever met in my life, and easily one of the greatest musicians that's ever lived. And he would say, hey, if you have two people, you have a rehearsal. So when I say chamber music group within a chamber music group, I don't mean starting a duet, you know, from within a quintet. You could do that too. But get two people from the group to sit down and rehearse together, even if it's not with all five people. So oftentimes you'll find, oh, you know, Billy can't be here because you know, he's got a bad zit and he doesn't want to go out in public. But you can have two people in a group meet, and you're going to have some, you're going to pay some big, big dividends where it comes to kind of learning about each other and getting those two parts to really, really gel and mix and work together. So that's kind of it for us. Now we were kind of thinking we'd take some questions and hear from you all and see if you have anything that you'd like to know about what we do. It doesn't necessarily have to be chamber music, anything we talked about in the slide, anything that has to do with chamber music or business, music business. We'd be happy to field those questions now.
Hey, Josh, while they're thinking of some questions, how about the piece you guys did at Midwest a couple years ago?
Which one are you referencing?
Chicago?
Yeah, let's do it.
Wow. Yeah, let me pull that up.
Here's the music from Chicago.
That just made me miss performing and touring so bad.
There's a couple here in the chat. Hey, Susan. Susan's back. She's been back for all three of ours so far. First of all, Jim wants to know, are the slides available for use later, or are those available somewhere?
You know what? I can
You want to send them to me and we can make them available?
Yeah, we can have that sent out.
So Jim, you can get those from KHS America. Just send an email to us and we can get those to you. Josh will send them to me. Susan says during this time of COVID and most schools very limited with the correct amount of space, they have small chamber group are the way to go. Love the idea of doing a chamber music. So with the music being arranged, are the publishers allowing the music to be rearranged? Yeah, that's a great question.
So for us, when we do it, yes, we reach out, we get the rights, and we rearrange those. Most schools though, you have a lot of flexibility, as an educational institution, to be able to do that. It just depends on whether or not most schools do are members of ASCAP BMI. So you're going to pay those dues, for performances, but, Steve looks like he's got something to add where that's concerned.
Well, I know what you mean when you said, do they allow it to be rearranged? And some institutions like Andrew Lloyd Webber, they're a little bit more strict, in what they allow us to do. So when we got the rights to do Phantom of the Opera, we essentially, we sort of cheated a little bit. We went ahead and got the rights for a very sort of dumbed down version that didn't go off the original. And then we ornament live. So that's kind of how we got around that, but don't go repeating that, please.
Good thing you put it out for the whole world, but you know, it's good. Yeah.
I think people might want to know, since I know all you guys and sure miss all you guys, getting to hang out with you and listen to you play, and that watching you play in Midwest a few years ago, seeing that again was such a great experience. And I know that was one of your first experiences at Midwest as well. So, can you just each individually talk a little bit about your high school experience and what was it that made you realize this is what you wanted to do, whether that was to be in chamber music, but I always enjoyed as a former educator listening to what inspired somebody. So we'll just start with Steve and go around.
Well, I grew up in Northern Virginia. So I was in, it was actually Falls Church, Virginia, which is just a few miles outside of DC. And I started taking trumpet lessons at a pretty young age. I was about 12 or 13. And my first teacher was a guy named Chuck Sipe, who played in the Army band. And in the summers, I remember going and hearing the Army band play on like the Lincoln Center steps or something like that. And it was just incredible. And one of the concerts I remember was Chuck playing Carnival of Venice, and he wore like a one-fingered puppet and played the end variation. And I don't know, I was just kind of blown away. And I'd say it was moments like that as a kid, seeing live performers, you know, professionals do it at a super high level, that just kind of put me in that direction. And that's what did it for me. So I'm going to pass it on to Jeff.
Yeah, let's see. I grew up in central Maryland, just outside of Baltimore, maybe 10, 15 minutes west, right in the middle of the state. I got interested in brass music. The whole family was musical, piano lessons, guitar. Dad was in a garage band kind of group. I actually saw a group in elementary school very similar to Presidio Brass. It was an assembly. Everybody loved assembly. You go sit on the cafetorium floor, and a group comes in. It was this brass group, and they showed everybody the instruments. They displayed it, and as soon as I saw the trombone player like empty a spit valve and like everyone went, ooh, I was like, I want to play that one. That looks really cool. So I picked it up, did lessons throughout middle school, made all county, got into high school, got into all the groups. I was just really into it. Super band nerdy, loved it. I was a drum major in the marching band. It was the moment that clicked for me. I was actually thinking about this today, because being a graduate student, you kind of have to like relive all this stuff and listen to all this stuff. And I had like one of those like eureka moments, like a Holst piece. I played in a community orchestra. We played Jupiter by Holst. And I just remember that was the first moment I kind of got like the goosebumps, like went on stage performing that. And that's the moment I was like, I kind of want to do this and try to make a living. So it was pushed upon me. My director and bands was like, you should probably do this group. I think it'd be good for you. And so it was outside, rehearse on Sunday nights. I had to miss all the football games, miss the Super Bowl, just to rehearse Festive Overture. and stuff like that. But I think that was very beneficial, having that little push from my band director to get me something that he knew what I would enjoy. I didn't know it yet. And so that's what kind of launched it. Go, Mike.
My turn. Okay, so I've kind of been involved in music for the majority of my life. I started on piano lessons when I was 6, but at the time, it was very much just a thing that my parents were forcing me to do. It didn't really seem like something that I was going to do for my entire life. But then come middle school, our middle school band director was also actually a professional recording artist by the name of Randy Scott. You can probably look him up. He's just won some award lately. But he was the kind of band director who was constantly bringing his instrument into class, and he was always playing all this really cool music for us. He had an electronic wind instrument that he would play for us, and he had such a way of making everything about music just seem so cool. And in the 8th grade, you know, I'd been playing tuba for 3 years at that time. He actually took me into his studio in the basement of his house, and he let me write and record a piece with him for an 8th grade project. And that was one of my first times in a professional music setting. And pretty much from that point on, I knew that I wanted to do something like that for the rest of my life.
Miles, you go next.
I'll go next. Yeah, I mean, I had wonderful middle school and high school band experiences. I will definitely say that my director and the lengths he went to create an environment of learning and bringing in of guest soloists and, you know, kind of like extra educational seminars that we went to were they were like the determining factor of why I went into music later on. I mean, my freshman year of high school, Patrick Sheridan and Sam Palafian arranged the music for a marching band show, and he brought them out to do breathing gym and be guest solos with our concert band. Wayne Bergeron was a soloist with my high school jazz band. And so, like, being exposed to those types of things definitely pushed me in the direction of pursuing music as a career. I mean, I always really liked trumpet. You know, I started in elementary school. I really enjoyed playing through middle school. But I always, like, since I was young, I was like, I'm going to be an architect when I grow up. And then having those experiences in high school and a director who really was a trumpet player himself, and he really took me under his wing to, like, push me to expand my skill set and gave me things to listen to and to work on, that was the major influence in why I chose to become a professional musician. And I'll always, like, be very thankful for that. Go ahead,
Joshy. I opted to go last because my musical upbringing is a little atypical. Both of my parents were music educators for 40 years, each of them. My mom's in the Florida Vocal Association Hall of Fame. And so when people are like, how'd you get into music? And I'm like, because there really wasn't a choice, or at least not a choice that I knew of. Actually, I kind of grew up with just music was just that was just music was life, you know, whether it was going to my mom's performances and rehearsals and singing with her choirs at a young age, or, you know, sitting down and my dad would play Blood, Sweat, and Tears for me. But I do remember he sat down and played this Blood, Sweat, and Tears record. And I was all eaten up at that point. I was gonna be like the trombonist on that record. But I think what really did it for me early on, as I had really, really excellent music teachers, my first band director in 6th grade, you know, I took piano lessons as a really young kid, but it didn't really stick. I wasn't really into it. And my first band director was a professional tubist as well as a middle school band director. And I would sit in my mom's choral room after school and he would practice. And I had these amazing early models of what just a beautiful tuba sound was like. And I had great teaching. And as I got older, I think the pivotal thing for me was that I never ever, you know, I was always very, very precocious, but I never had anybody tell me that there was something I couldn't do. I never had anybody tell me something was hard. I never had anybody tell me that something I was playing was too advanced, or that I was something I was trying to do was too much. And so I just didn't know any better. And I aimed for the stars, and I, you know, I got to, you know, Alabama. But I'm from a very small town. At the time of when I graduated high school, the town I'm from in Florida had 9 stoplights and one high school, one middle school. And so, you know, music has always been a way for me to kind of transcend, I guess you could say, that small town boy kind of thing. And but really for me, it was always that my educators, they praised what I was doing and they believed in what I was doing. And so did my parents. I can't speak enough about how important it is to have, you know, involved parents. And that's not something as music educators that we always have control over, but that's a pivotal thing. So I see that Susan Smith has asked us, what was your most fun performance? And I'm going to come right out of the gate and say that it wasn't the most fun for me. We had a performance in Kansas Music Educators Association. And I got up, we did something we don't normally do, which is fly in the day of the gig. I got up in the morning and I went to the airport. My flight was delayed and delayed and delayed. There was a fog that wouldn't lift. And at one point I was juggling. I had purchased 5 different flights from 5 different airlines, and probably much to Rick DeYoung's chagrin, because most of it was on his credit card. And but at any rate, they all got canceled. And so I'm going, oh my gosh, what am I going to do? Well, Steve says, hey, look, there's a flight over in Tallahassee. Can you get there? And I looked at my watch and I said, yeah, I can do it. So I ran back to the car. I drove down there. I had just enough time when I got there to get in through security. I ditched every bit of luggage that I had that I couldn't hold on to with me, so that I could just walk through security. Everything was delayed. I changed in the airport bathroom between flights and into my suit, and they held the concert for us for, I think it was like 30 minutes. Is that right, Steve? Yeah. So they send somebody to pick me up at the airport. I get in the cab. They drop me off at the backstage door. I walk in, unpack my trombone, and go boop. And I'm like, all right, guys, let's do it. We walked out on stage, and the audience was just like the most energetic audience. I mean, we play Bohemian Rhapsody, and it's just a sea of phone lights going and screaming. And I mean, it just made you feel like a real rock star, you know, not a classical music rock star, but a real one, especially because they had the good deli meat backstage. So that was it for us, man. No red M&Ms, but good deli meat. Somebody else talk now.
I'll speak up for Midwest. I mean, that's just such an amazing, you know, environment, and it's the whole audience is people who know what's up, right? And so if you are able to impress them and give them a good show, then, you know, you're actually really doing something right. You know, it's not kind of an uninformed audience. And so being given the opportunity to do that, you know, we played there twice. And the first year was kind of an exhibition performance, but the second year we went was like a featured thing. And so we had about 1,000, you know, band directors in there. And I think we got them pretty early and they were eating it up. And so it's a real fun thing to, you know, have something that you put a lot of work into, designing, choreographing, rehearsing, memorizing the music for, being stressed out about on a daily basis about, you know, that how you're playing, or whether you remember all the steps to do, and then for it all to come together is really cool and rewarding. And it never gets not scary. So that's always fun.
So again, thanks for all showing up. Remember to look for your professional development certificate to come to you as an email. And my thanks to Mike and Miles and Jeff and Steve and Josh and everything they do for music education out there, and the Presidio Brass. So once again, thank you for coming, and we hope to see everybody next Thursday.